Hello, my name is Apostolia Tsirikoglou and I will present our state-of-the-art report, a survey of image synthesis methods for visual machine learning. I will divide this presentation in two parts. In the first part, we will see why we need synthetic data in machine learning, and give a short introduction on our studies framework, explaining what it is included or excluded. Further, we will have a short background on content generation and rendering, and we will continue with a discussion around real and synthetic data. We will talk about optimal data generation and reasons and possible solutions for the domain shift between real and synthetic sets. We will also have a closer look on the currently developing learning-based image synthesis methods. And finally, we will briefly touch on the potential of synthetic data as a benchmarking tool, as well as some privacy and ethics issues that come with synthesis methods and data usage. In the second part, we will see closer the image synthesis pipeline and describe the available solutions for both modeling and rendering. We will also go through two commonly used schemes for increasing modeling and rendering variation. Following, we will see representative examples of image synthesis in various computer vision areas. In specific, we will go through popular vision tasks that utilize synthetic training data, and at the same time, we will highlight the modeling and rendering choices they made. We will close this session summarizing how computer vision can benefit from image synthesis for machine learning, and how the developed synthetic training data can contribute towards better solutions. Starting with the first part and the motivation of this survey, we identify that no matter the potential of a model and the computational resources, the end performance will suffer if the training data do not cover the distribution of the target domain. Data collection is a limiting factor, not only due to the actual capturing process, but most often because annotations for supervised learning can be expensive and time-consuming to generate. Moreover, it is difficult to cover all possible situations that are relevant. Common data augmentation techniques can be partially a solution, but they are limited by the available data at hand. On top of that, modern deep learning algorithms call for large amounts of data. So, synthetic data have the potential to become a vital component in the training pipeline of machine learning applications, as they can generate large quantities of fully annotated training data, and they come with full control during the generation process. This control is vital for content variety and in order to formulate the best data distribution. Given this, and recognizing the potential of future development, this survey brings together the various generation methods that they have been developed the past decade for categorization and comparisons. To set the ground, we start with a definition of visual machine learning. This concerns all the tasks connected to visual perception and includes algorithms that use training data. Furthermore, this survey includes image synthesis methods that create whole, standalone training datasets and excludes all the rest, like data augmentation methods and synthesized testing datasets. Just to give a short background on visual data generation, we will go through its main components: scene generation and rendering. Scene generation is a process of building up the virtual environment in which the sensors will be simulated. This may range from simplistic objects to fully featured virtual worlds, including geometries, materials, light sources, optics, and various kinds of sensors. There are two basic approaches for content generation. The first one is to build an entire fixed virtual scene where the simulated sensors will be navigated. This approach relies mostly to manual effort and artistic work and results to limited data variation, since the possible generated images build on a finite set of features. The second approach for content production generates scenes on demand and creates only what it is currently viewed by the simulated sensors. Such on-demand content generation can be achieved using procedural methods, and even though it can be more time-consuming per frame, it results to more content-rich data variations. Rendering is the second component of the visual data generation pipeline. And by rendering, we mean the light transport simulation in the environment and how the simulated sensors capture the virtual world. Rendering and sensor simulation can be broadly divided into two main techniques: rasterization and ray or path tracing. In rasterization, the 3D objects are represented by polygons, usually triangles, that are traversed on the screen and converted into color pixels. In rasterization, in order to achieve realistic rendering results, there are needed pre-computations for the complete scattering effects or global illumination. However, these pre-computations can be computationally complex and with scalability issues. In general, rasterization is fast, as it allows for GPU rendering and quick generation of sequential images of the same environment, and this is why it is the basic rendering method for computer video games. However, it's limited by the needed pre-computations and the level of realism that can be achieved. On the other hand, in path tracing, sample paths are stochastically generated in the image plane and traced through the scene. At each interaction, the light-emitting objects are sampled and their contribution is summed up. Path tracing is therefore extremely general and can simulate any type of lighting effects, including multiple light bounces, combinations between complex geometries and material scattering behaviors, and a wide range of sensors without the need of pre-computations. The drawback, however, is that it is computationally expensive, but at the same time it parallelizes and scales well, and it's feasible through Monte Carlo important sampling techniques and efficient data structure structures for accelerating the geometric computations. Leaving back this brief introduction on visual data generation, we can now move on and see which properties are optimal for a training dataset and what issues arise between real and synthetic domains. But first, let's take a closer look on how captured and virtual data are defined and which qualities that are desirable for a training set they do have or not. It is quite straightforward how real data are captured. Focusing on supervised machine learning applications, the collection of real-world data requires significant efforts both for capturing but mostly for annotating them. Virtual data are the outcome of the visual data generation pipeline. Depending on the modeling and rendering design choices that we will go through in detail later, the generated data are produced with various levels of complexity. However, and no matter the resulting data complexity, image synthesis methods are capable of generating pixel-perfect ground truth annotations automatically. Both captured and virtual data can include content diversity. However, it is much easier to generate the so-called hard cases than to capture them. By hard cases, we mean the long tail of the target domain distribution. This includes scenarios that do not happen often, or scenarios that when they happen, it is difficult to capture. Hard cases completion is just one example of the full control over the data generation process that image synthesis has compared to data capturing. Another one is scalability. Most supervised deep learning applications require large amounts of data. It is therefore necessary that the data generation process scales easily both in content generation and sensor simulation. Another key component of synthetic data is that high-quality metadata can be generated. This can be very useful for model and data analysis. Lastly, and even though we can reduce the bias that we introduce both in real and synthetic training data, image synthesis enables higher levels of privacy when it comes to sensitive features. It has become clear then that synthesizing image data prevails over capturing, with the main advantages to be the reduced collection times and annotation cost, scalability, and feature variation and coverage. And by that, we do not only mean the previously mentioned hard cases. The features included in the generated data should be generally diverse, meaning that they should cover all the possible application domain densely enough in order for them to be representative of the real data distribution. However, one problem of using synthetic training images in machine learning is that the domain gap between them and the relevant real target domain is still substantial. This shift can be measured, and it is often the case that it's not larger than in between real datasets domain gap. However, it should be minimized, either directly in the synthesis or by applying some domain transfer model. Reasons for this domain gap between synthetic and real data often lie both to rendering performance and scene modeling. This implies that since photorealistic rendering is possible, the problem lies mainly in computational resources and in simulating over details in a realistic way. Such details include geometries, materials, light sources, camera parameters, and even imperfections. We cannot skip mentioning that if real data are also available, the diversity induced by combining them with the synthetic ones is also a significant factor to increase generalization and reduce the domain gap to the target application. Apart from the well-established classical computer graphics visual data generation, we are currently witnessing a tremendous progress in generative modeling, mainly using GANs. And we are today approaching the point where GANs will be used for image synthesis of training data. The high-fidelity synthetic examples you see here are not generated to serve as training data for machine learning, but they show the potential of this data generation method. An interesting application of learning-based image synthesis is medical imaging. Here, GANs have already been a popular choice for data augmentation purposes. One such example utilized generative modeling through image-to-image translation under various configurations in order to create histopathology images for cancer detection. The synthesized data, examples of which you can see in this slide, were generated using CycleGANs in order to augment the initial training set of real data. This initial set of real data was limited, a case that can be common for many cancer types in digital pathology. Generative modeling provided a working solution where, through domain adaptation, more target domain-alike data generated and augmented the initial training set. Apart from data augmentation, though, large-scale generative image synthesis for training data in medical imaging is interesting for several reasons. First, it is difficult to collect large amounts of medical data. This can be due to the nature of some medical conditions, restrictions in capturing, that in some cases involve infrastructure issues too, and the high annotations cost that require time-consuming efforts from specialists. Moreover, medical images are usually represented by different modalities than natural images, such as computed tomography scans, magnetic resonance imaging, ultrasounds, and digital pathology slides. It is therefore not possible to use classical image generation methods, and this way, GANs can be a suitable choice for image synthesis. Another issue that generative image synthesis attempts to tackle refers to anonymization of medical data. This is an important topic both in medical imaging and data sharing, in order to guarantee privacy for the test subjects. Although there have been some efforts to conceal sensitive features from such data, the risks of de-anonymization remain high. Image synthesis with GANs can provide a viable alternative for anonymized medical training data. This solution can benefit several applications with large and diverse sets of generated images that ideally will carry all the relevant information of the target spectrum and that will have the possibility to be publicly released to the research community. However, despite the potential, there are limitations. These are related to the fact that it is still difficult to allow for complete control over the image generation process, and that the generative modeling cannot go outside the distribution of the data used to train the model. This means that in order to allow more control and to enable the generation of images far from the training data distribution, the image generation process needs to be formulated differently. Recent works towards this direction suggest to train ensembles of GANs. They show that for the purpose of generating more diverse training data, the most important aspect is to combine multiple GANs, even if they are trained completely independently. Moreover, in order to increase control in image synthesis, it is also possible to use hybrid techniques that mix GANs and classical methods for scene or image generation. One such example, related to digital pathology and nuclear segmentation, proposes a hybrid synthesis pipeline that utilizes textures from real histopathology patches and GAN models. Here, an initial synthetic pathology image patch is generated through classical image processing methods, and then it gets refined through a GAN module. Moving away from the learning-based image synthesis, we would also like to highlight the potential that synthetic data have to evaluate models' performance. Currently, the standard approach is to learn from synthesized data and evaluate on real-world data. And this makes sense, as usually the end goal is to use the trained model in a real-world scenario. However, it could be interesting for benchmarking purposes to evaluate the models on high-quality, synthetically generated images. We know that classical image synthesis provides full control over the data generation and the features distribution. This control enables the generation of various scene configurations, or else data versions, that can be used to benchmark the model's performance under different circumstances that, for example, may be difficult to capture or they are outside the training data distribution. Full control over the generation process comes also with the possibility to automatically create a rich set of selected metadata. This in turn enables extensive statistical testing across different parameters. Metadata can be related to features like depth or camera parameters and can be generated in flexible ways, like at per pixel, image, or instance level, depending on the analysis needs and purposes. However, we need to highlight that image and metadata synthesis for benchmarking requires careful data generation that will produce synthesized images representative for both the evaluated task and the real data counterpart. Closing this discussion and the first part of the presentation, we need to emphasize that the more we support the development of data generation methods and the use of synthetic visual training data, the more we recognize the need for well-defined synthesis and utilization frameworks. Data generation methods can be used to ensure both data diversity and individual privacy protection, especially when personal information are involved. They are also capable of integrating the world's variations directly in the generation pipeline, and therefore they are capable of reducing the bias introduced in the training sets. Under the general context of ethics, we believe that the use of synthetic data in a legal and human rights preserving manner can contribute to the democratization of computer vision applications. The need of synthetic training data calls for content generation methods that depict reality and provide enough variations of both the majority and minority scenarios. In the second part, we will now look closer to the image synthesis pipeline from a computer graphics perspective, going through in detail its modeling and rendering components. We will also see what design choices can be made in order to encourage data diversity. Then, we will see some of the most popular computer vision applications that utilized image synthesis methods the past decade, while at the same time we will be highlighting the most common modeling and rendering choices they made. Lastly, we will wrap up this session by gathering the main aspects where the various computer vision tasks can benefit from image synthesis, and we will end with some closing remarks. There are two major consecutive steps in the image synthesis pipeline: modeling followed by rendering. Each one of these steps can be conducted in a number of different ways, relying on a larger or smaller extent to physics definitions or approximations of reality. Modeling is a process of developing a representation of all aspects related to the scene content, ranging from the configuration of 3D object models to surface textures and light sources. In modeling, all the constituting elements of a scene can be either procedurally or non-procedurally generated. Procedural modeling is the use of algorithms and mathematical functions to determine the layout of a scene, the shape of an object, or the color and pattern of a texture. In reality, procedural modeling is about parameterizing the generation process and can be applied to any factor of scene content creation, providing a high level of control, flexibility, and variability. Taking as an example the generation of a synthetic training set of urban environments using procedural methods, the construction of the virtual world is defined by a set of parameters and a rule set that translates the parameter values into the concrete scene definition. This means that each scene configuration, in essence each generated image, can be thought of as a sampling of the generating parameter space, and that it is possible to shape the virtual world by associating each parameter to a statistical distribution. This way, procedural generation leads to individual unique results. The scene construction can be defined by fully procedural objects, or in some cases by a mixture of procedurally generated models along with objects from model libraries. For example, previous street scene parsing synthetic datasets have utilized procedural generation for a number of classes, like buildings and road textures, while some others, like pedestrians and car models, were fetched from libraries. In cases like this, even though some geometry is shared between all scenes that use it, large variability can be achieved by varying properties such as placement, orientation, textures, and simulated materials. On the contrary, non-procedural modeling relies mostly on manual efforts and artistic work, and it does not involve any automatic generation procedures. Besides being procedural or not, scene generation can be further categorized according to how the attributes of the scenes are modeled. Data-driven modeling focuses on developing statistical models based on high-quality sensor data and measurement procedures like motion captures and 3D laser scannings. The acquired data can be fitted to parametric models or fed to learning-based non-parametric methods. This way, we can create reliable approximations of real-world elements that they do not have well-defined mathematical representations, or where a physically based model cannot be used due to limitations of the computer graphics generation system. For example, and as it is shown here in this slide, a data-driven approach to learn a statistical model for the shape of an elephant could use 3D laser scans taken from several subjects. In the general context of image synthesis for training data, data-driven modeling has been widely used for human face and body modeling and material representations. Physically based modeling is generally defined by certain and well-established processes, usually described mathematically from laws of physics. In the context of this survey, we expand the term to also include handcrafted models that only visually follow the laws of the physical world and not necessarily use of scientific formulations, but rather they rely on perceptual similarity. For example, the shown scene consists of 3D models of an elephant next to a cat that it is approximately 10 times shorter. This would be classified as physically based modeling, while the opposite could not, as from just visual inspection, this would violate the rules of proportion. Finally, non-physically based modeling includes everything that cannot lie in physical brains modeling. This is seen content that does not follow any physical rule, accurately or approximately. These models are usually developed according to some random scheme, or they follow an abstract or fictional concept, like the one depicted in this slide. Modeling is followed by rendering, which is the process of generating an image out of the 3D scene configuration. It is a computational technique that attempts to simulate in various levels of accuracy the light transport between the light sources and the various materials from a defined viewpoint. Rendering is categorized according to three main directions for image synthesis: real-time, offline, and what we call object infusion. You also see here that learning-based methods are included. These methods are operating directly in pixel space and produce an image out of a neural network. And in this sense, they differentiate from the classical computer graphics rendering formulation. Looking at the real-time rendering, there have been three approaches for training data generation. These approaches either acquire existing data from real-time game environments or directly generate images using real-time visual simulators. A game engine is the software package that includes all the necessary elements to build the computer game. Over the past few years, game engines are more accessible, and at the same time, they are able to render more realistic images. These facts made them a source of synthetic data for several vision applications. Synthetic training data have been produced with two ways related to game engines: either directly on the game development platform, or by extracting already existing visual data from commercial games without accessing the game's source code or content. This last approach relies on understanding how the rendering pipeline is integrated into the GPU and on building dedicated software solutions for their communication. Another real-time rendering method for synthetic data production is based on virtual world generators created with 3D development platforms, such as Unity or Unreal Engine. Initially, these platforms were mainly aimed for game development, but nowadays, they offer tools for cinematics, automotive, and engineering applications too. Both dedicated game engines and 3D development platforms are based on rasterization with lighting pre-computations in order to achieve high frame rates. Modern platforms have started to provide real-time ray tracing effects and capabilities. However, these are made feasible by hybrid techniques that combine sampling schemes with denoising and require specialized graphics hardware to run. Lastly, other kinds of simulators, like driving simulators and physics engines, have been another source for collecting synthetic data for visual machine learning. Some of them, they have been implemented to initially serve other research purposes, but since they provide visual representations, they have been suitable for synthetic visual training data collection as well. On the other side of real-time rendering is offline rendering, where the speed is not a determinant factor. Here, both CPU and GPU can be used, and apart from simple methods like rasterization, they are enabled more accurate approximations of light transport, such as ray and path tracing. Till now, offline, physically based rendering is usually the only way to achieve photorealistic results. There are several offline rendering implementations that they have been used for synthetic data generation, including standalone solutions or integrated renderers to open source or commercial 3D computer graphics programs. Finally, we define as object infusion the methods that render single or multiple 3D objects offline and then infuse them on a background image to construct the final result. We also include in this category the image synthesis methods that use a cut and paste style approach. This approach removes one or more objects from an image, maybe modifies them, and then inserts them again back to the same or to a new background image. The synthesis pipeline you see in this slide is a representative example, where a 3D model of a car is rendered offline under various rendering settings, and then it is infused into a background image for the final composition. During this survey, we identified two basic modeling and rendering design choices that both aim to bridge the gap between synthetic data and real world. Domain randomization is one of them, and it tries to fill the domain gap between training and testing sets by randomizing the content in the simulated environments that produce the training data. Following a similar concept, rendering randomization randomizes the lighting conditions and camera configurations for image rendering. Lighting conditions include the number, type, position, and intensities of the light sources in the scene, while camera configurations involve variations in location or trajectory of the camera, as well as variations in the extrinsic parameters of the cameras, of the simulated cameras. This synthesis pipeline utilizes both domain and rendering randomization. Basic 3D geometric shapes, like spheres, cubes, etc., are inserted in the scene in random configurations, while the final result is rendered from a random viewpoint. The outcome is not necessarily realistic, but it tries to force the model to learn the essential features of interest. Both domain and rendering randomizations are simple techniques, and basically they can be applied pretty much to every generation method. What they aim to is that by providing enough variability at training time to make the real world appear to the model as yet another variation. Moving on, there are several active areas in computer vision that the last decade make use of and benefit from image synthesis methods as a source of generating training data. These include, but they are not limited to, human body and object pose estimation, optical flow, depth and disparity estimation, semantic segmentation, object detection, face recognition, visual odometry, camera design, noise modeling, and intrinsic image decomposition. Grouping the synthesized training data and the image synthesis methods over the computer vision areas and time, it is easy to see that recognition tasks are the number one area to utilize synthetic data for training. This is not relevant with the autonomous driving outbreak since 2016, where mainly semantic segmentation and object detection gathered a lot of attention. Large-scale synthetic data that come with pixel-perfect, automatic or semi-automatic in some cases, ground truth annotations, pose a perfect solution for tasks like this, where annotation of real captured data have been reported to need something between 20 to 90 minutes per frame. Following recognition tasks, intrinsic decomposition, depth estimation, optical flow, and human body pose estimation are the tasks where image synthesis for training has been widely used. As for the most popular modeling and rendering choices across all the studied synthetic data and image synthesis methods, and over all the computer vision tasks, non-procedural, physically based modeling is the most commonly selected, while real-time rendering or offline rendering was the rendering choice for most of the image synthesis methods. In this parallel coordinates plot, it is also provided the originally reported performance and a qualitative ranking that indicates the data complexity. Data complexity refers to computational efficiency, which is mostly depicted by the rendering speed, refers to visual complexity, which projects the computer graphics method's depth, and also refers to data production competence, which is related to the production pipeline efficiency. The presentation format does not allow for intuitive representations of this quality score, and therefore, in what follows, we will go through some of the computer vision applications that broadly use synthetic training data, and we will also provide visual examples of the highly ranked methods with our qualitative score. Semantic segmentation is about identifying the contextual components or L classes of a scene. This task calls for pixel-perfect ground truth annotations. At the same time, this is its main limiting factor, as the labeling process requires significant manual efforts. To overcome this burden, there have been proposed semi-automatic labeling approaches that give synthetic real-time rendering training data. The depicted frame is an example of a large-scale set of extracted images from a commercial computer game that was built with non-procedural, physical-based modeling and rendered in real time. However, there have been also proposed automatic ground truth labels generation approaches that use more sophisticated image synthesis methods and employ procedural modeling and physically based rendering. An example is shown in this slide, and it was developed for outdoors semantic segmentation applications, while there have been similar ones for indoors scene understanding. The depicted example method used non-procedural physically based modeling along with offline accurate light transport approximation through photon mapping and domain and rendering randomization. Object detection is another recognition task, which aims to find all instances of a specific contextual class in an image. For this task, the majority of image generation methods employed physically based modeling coupled with real-time or offline rendering, while domain and rendering randomization was also commonly utilized. A such representative example is shown here, utilizing procedural modeling within a 3D development platform. Finally, among the various recognition tasks, face recognition is one of the most popular. Face analysis has been in the center of research attention for many years, as it provides a powerful tool to automatically interpret humans, their interactions, and their expressions. It is a mature discipline, and quite a few synthetic data generation methods have assisted to provide solutions. Most of these involve fitting a statistical 3D model to captured data and sampling from it in order to vary the facial properties and expression parameters. This way, a diverse synthetic training dataset can be created. Additionally, rendering randomization is commonly used, along with object infusion. The given example uses data-driven modeling where a 3D face model template that also includes a shape and texture component is fitted to real face scans and then rendered and infused to image backgrounds. Moving away from recognition applications, intrinsic image decomposition refers to image deconstruction into reflectance and illumination components. Here, all of the associated synthetic training data were generated with offline rendering that employs accurate light transport simulation through photon mapping or path tracing. Some of the image synthesis methods, like the one shown in this slide, use handcrafted, physically based modeled scenes and measured materials and employ rendering randomization, while others use non-physically based modeling incorporated in object infusion frameworks. The representative image synthesis method creates non-realistic images of non-procedural 3D models in multi-sided rooms with highly variable reflectance walls, rendered offline in an object infusion fashion. Depth and disparity estimation are closely connected tasks in stereo matching. Given a rectified image pair, depth refers to the subjective distance to the objects as it is perceived by the viewer. The majority of synthetic data generation frameworks for depth estimation rely on extracting non-procedural physically based scenes from games or other simulators. Disparity estimation refers to the relative difference in the positions of the objects in two images. For this task, most synthetic training data were generated through also non-procedural modeling and real-time or offline rendering. In this slide, we see one of the commonly used synthetic training datasets that has been developed out of a short animated film. This dataset employs non-physically based modeling and offline rendering. Optical flow is described by a displacement vector field related to the pixels of subsequent frames. It is one of the most challenging and widely used tasks in computer vision, where ground truth correspondence fields are very difficult to acquire. It came then natural that synthetic data got a central role in machine learning methods, not only for training, but also for evaluation purposes too. These frames are representative examples of one of the first synthetic training data for optical flow. Despite the fact that they were only a few, just 8, and therefore they could not constitute a training set for modern deep learning applications, we mention them for their historical significance and benchmark value. They use procedural modeling for one natural and one urban scene. The scenes were composed with a random selection of textures and surface displacements and rendered offline using the ambient occlusion approximation to global illumination. Since then, several methods have been developed, with the majority to use non-procedural, physically based modeling, along with offline rendering and domain randomization. Here, in this slide, we see flying chairs that utilize non-procedural, physically based modeling, object infusion, and domain randomization. And along with flying things 3D, are representative examples and two of the most commonly used large-scale training datasets for optical flow estimation. Flying things 3D also use physically based modeling with some procedural textures creation in an end-to-end offline rendering pipeline with domain randomization. Finally, human body or articulated pose estimation is an important problem within general pose estimation, where the configuration of a human body is estimated from a single image. For this task, synthetic data generation frameworks are typically based on data-driven modeling methods and employ object infusion techniques. They also usually use rendering randomization along with randomly sampled texture maps and background pictures to induce data diversity and higher complexity. Here, you see representative examples that use data-driven modeling in an object infusion framework along with rendering randomization. Closing this session, we will try to gather the main points that show how computer vision can benefit from synthetic training data and image synthesis frameworks. The first and foremost benefit concerns the automatic ground truth generation. Especially for problems like optical flow and semantic segmentation, where the annotation process is expensive, synthetic data provide a viable alternative. At the same time, an image synthesis generation pipeline can be configured to output several kinds of annotation types, several kinds of labels. This way, several tasks can benefit from one synthesized training set. Moreover, image synthesis methods come with full control over the data generation. Compared to capturing procedures, visual data generation enables large-scale production with extended content and complexity variation at a lower effort cost. Lastly, computer-generated visual data can also play an important role when evaluating models. Their ability on features variation and metadata generation open up possibilities in detailed statistical testing across different kinds of parameters. In the same spirit, and thinking of how image synthesis frameworks can work to the benefit of the various vision applications, we recognize that first, they should identify and group the needs of relevant applications and then develop corresponding training data in order to meet these needs. For example, there are certain fields like optical flow and depth and disparity estimation where image diversity is desirable over realism. The same does not hold for other groups of tasks, like recognition, where both diversity and realism are a must. In every case, though, features variation and data diversity are necessary. Apart from contextual content variation, domain and rendering randomization are techniques that help towards this direction. Finally, we know that image synthesis has the foundation to become an almost fully automatic process while producing photorealistic results. What is needed is that all the associated components are fully simulated, from geometries to camera settings and imperfections. Automatic image synthesis processes that could scale up easily will be able to provide large amounts of high fidelity training data for visual machine learning. Wrapping up, we have now seen that synthetic training data and synthesis methods for visual machine learning have been flourishing the past decade and they continue to develop. As their quality improves, their use will be extended and they will play even more of a central role in solving computer vision problems. At the same time, and while classical image synthesis methods are mature and well-established, we are currently witnessing the development of learning-based image synthesis methods for training data, with a wide range of active research around, from natural images to medical images. This survey and presentation aim not to present a static, limited list of image synthesis methods, but rather wants to emphasize that visual training data generation is an evolving field. More synthesis methods and their visual outcomes will keep being added and extend the presented categories. But all will have the same common goal: to boost models' performance and provide wider feature coverage and overall generalization. And with this, I would like to thank you all for your attention and to refer you to our paper for further details and discussions. Thank you.